Hi, I'm Carol. I'm from Front Range Community College, and I'm at the Resource Development Office.
Yeah, I'm Curtis Turner from Lamar Community College.
How about James?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
All right.
And then we have John.
Hi, this is John. I'm from Ames Community College.
Awesome. Kelly?
Yep, I'm here from Lamar Community College, and Cheryl Sanchez is here with me.
Awesome. Linda?
This is Linda Raines from Pikes Peak.
Matt Jamison, Front Range Community College.
Ruth Meads, Front Range Community College.
And I'm Brenda Brown, the Instructional Design Coordinator for the Factory Grant. And what we actually needed to do is bring everybody together today so that we could actually run through this quick agenda. The large group discussion is about telling how colleges plan to construct and deliver online content. Subsection of that is a percent of instructor-created content for the grant guidelines. Right now it's 90% original content, 10% purchase content, let's put it that way. Percent of the content that we were required to be delivered through the hybrid or online. If we decide to deviate from what the grant guidelines are, we actually need to put in a statement of work amendment, and I'll let Casey talk about that. Then we're going to go ahead and break into identifying the specific certificates that we plan to build for the project, the courses, the small group breakout in cohorts. My experience from the TAC 1 grant is that we have 13 schools building the exact same course. Towards the end, everybody was scrambling because they hadn't actually done some of the courses that had not been duplicated. So this time around, what we're hoping to do is create, if everybody needs a safety course, then build one master safety course, ship it out to all the other colleges, and they can tweak it at their own college. That way, other colleges can concentrate on certificates and courses that have not actually been created. And I know MSU is creating 3 new courses. Front Range is creating a brand new certificate. So there's a lot of work to be completed in this first year because according to the deadline that Casey set last meeting, our courses have to be completed for spring 15 enrollment. That gives you exactly a year to get all the courses online and ready for enrollment January 15th. Does that make sense? Is that unclear? Right, and OER status, because we're still held to OER status, Open Education Resource.
Brenda?
Yes.
Could you repeat the question that the participant says? Because we can't hear what they say clearly. We can hear you clearly, but not what people say in the room.
Okay. Ruth asked to clarify delivery online versus hybrid online content delivered online. And my response was that courses have to be ready for student enrollment, whether it's face-to-face, hybrid, or online status, by January 15th. However, whether you choose face-to-face, hybrid, or online status, your courses have to be an open educational resource by January 15 as well.
Thanks.
So the open educational resources will be either publishing your content from the wall, connections, or if you work on a Canvas system, you just open up your course with a URL. No, 15, 2015. There's a question again from Ruth. Claire, they have to be ready for enrollment January 2015, not in 2 months. Okay. There also needs to be a discussion. Industry is wanting us to be able to modularize our courses, and we need to have a discussion about how we can actually modularize our courses so that it meets industry needs as well as colleges' needs instead of right now the way they're set up, I think. And that's it. So we're going to go ahead and let Casey take over as to the statement of work, how we want to actually approach that, if we want to approach that.
We have a few people in the room and a few with us for industry.
And thank you guys so much for coming. We really appreciate it. And the reason they're here is because one of the things we found in the past is that sometimes we have a habit of hearing from our own advisory board, oh, here's what I want you to teach. And then we go create that, and that's it. And so it's in isolation. And one of the things that's really important throughout this project is that there's a feedback loop there, that we hear from our own advisory board, here's what we want you to teach. And then we work on that together, and then we give it back to them and say, is this right? And then we go teach it. And so that's a different process, certainly, than something that a lot of us used to doing. I know the folks on the phone from Pueblo have that down to a science, but we don't all have that down to a science. So we're working on it. And so we don't want to have any conversations about curriculum without inviting our partners in industry to the table. And I know today, in all our advisory board meetings, they'll start to get much more, okay, we'll have a crew working on building curriculum. And so then that crew can work together and not have to listen to all of the everybody else's stuff. But just to frame that, so part of the reason those folks are in the room and on the phone is so that we find ourselves never setting up a meeting to talk about, you know, what do we teach, how's the content look, without including everybody with the table. That's really important. So if you also on the phone start getting your industry partners, I know everyone's still, this is new, and we're still getting our list together, but to pull those people and make sure they're at the table and have these conversations, I think that's really important. The statement of work modification, we said in our grant that 90% of the content that we deliver to students is going to be something we create and 10% could be something we buy. So if you know there's software out there that's proprietary, and you know, oh, if we could just use, George, are you on the phone? George, what's the software you were saying that was so great?
Well, there's two we're considering. The first one earned for a product from Amitrol.
Okay, so there's something that Amitrol makes that George is like, this is really good. It does demos, it does what we need, it does what, and, you know, what kind of what we're thinking. And I feel like this conversation is potentially premature because we actually want to start down the path of what is the content and what does it look like and then see how we're going to develop it. But we know that it takes 6 months to get something like this back in the Department of Labor, and so we need to turn into our funder. We don't think we can do 90%. So the question becomes, how much of it do we think we want to buy? And that, I think, will come out of our next conversation, really, around getting colleges to identify, here are our courses, here's what it is that we plan on offering. We said we're going to do a NIM certificate. You all need to tell us what's in a NIM certificate that's so important. So we can figure out, is that two courses? Okay, here's what those two courses are. And like Rich was saying before we started, we need those to all be called the same two courses. So it's just about getting us on the same page, kind of the bigger overview. And I'll listen, and my ears are listening for, are you saying you need to buy this content, or are you saying that you need to create it yourself? And that will help frame the conversation around what percent we think can be proprietary versus not, and then I'll do the statement of work modification for us. So this is, that's what that is all about, and that's what I'm listening for. Does that answer your, what you're hoping for? Okay. So Brenda's really going to lead us through the curriculum and talking about which courses are we identifying so that we can break into smaller groups, and then the groups can actually work on the content that you're actually interested in. Thanks, Brenda.
Sure. So, yeah, that's where we're actually supposed to be heading, is to what is actually courses. First of all, a certificate and their courses. And I sent you a link last week so that you could actually look through the CCCS's active programs and the actual courses. MSU, you're going to have to compile this on your own because I don't have access to a central database that says this certificate has these courses. And I think I sent an email
that says, you know, you'll have to go through your course catalog to actually compile that and get that sent out. So it'll be actually over in that piece of 30 pages.
While I'm pulling up what I just brought up, do you want to go ahead and talk to us about what you brought for us today?
Excuse me, but
I apologize. I can't hear anything.
Linda, did you have a question?
I was just saying we couldn't hear any. I couldn't hear anything but rumbling. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, I couldn't hear anything but rumbling. I have no idea what the last 3 or 4 minutes was about. So.
Okay. Sorry about the technical difficulties. We had Shannon up from, I'm sorry, High Plains Welding. And he was giving us a synopsis of the breadth of his corporation and his experience with both higher ed, technical, and what the schools are saying out there.
No, I didn't have any questions. Thank you.
Okay. Callers on WebEx can actually see what I passed out, which was the required program curriculum for Front Rangers Machining. And you notice they have 11 new courses, machining 100 through 302, the blueprint reading. Okay, the question put before the group is, does any of our colleges currently offer any of those courses? Because if they do, then what we need to do is coordinate with Front Range and make sure not only are we teaching similar competencies, but they're all named the same. We're going to go ahead and divide up into the exact courses within each certificate. Did everybody, WebEx as well as here, actually have a list of your courses and certificates? What Casey did was she actually was very, very kind to me and created cohort groups. MSU, you're on here, but it was because I didn't get your certificates in time. But I can easily add them. CCD has 10 certificates, PCC, PCC, they're all up there. And then if we actually go through development teams, machining should be CCD, Front Range, High Peak, and Pueblo. Welding, CCD, and LCC. Engineering graphics would be PCC, AIMS, CCD, and Metro. Manufacturing is Red Rock, Emily Griffith, and Metro, and Electromechanical, PCC, and Metro. Does this make sense? Anybody from Front Range, can you tell us what's in your machining certificate courses? We're pulling this up. Do we have enough people here that might get a program coordinating? We have welding here for Emily Griffith, right? Anybody else? How about Metro and people who get together? Just go ahead and break into small groups and start talking about the certificate, your courses. And one of the things you actually need to decide today is if you actually have that certificate and you have those exact courses already running, like either they're face-to-face, hybrid, or online. So we can actually say, okay, you probably don't need to spend a lot of development time on that, but if you have a certificate that you have to have 3 or 4 new courses with, we need to know that, because that actually, you need to spend more energy on developing those kind of courses. Does that make sense? So go ahead, you can rearrange the room whatever you want, but get with your group.
On that little chart that was just up there, that said college in some area, what area were you?
What? Oh, yeah. 3D printing and additive manufacturing certificate. Do you have anybody here who's going to do those two? Okay, so Metro's here to help.
So, Bruce, Chris also and the Metro team.
Someone's working.
Okay, so what your assignment is right now is to talk to people who are in a similar area to you and identify what is actually in your program. So if you told us your program is MIMS, I have no idea what I'm tracking. I don't know what that is. And what we crosswalk to is at the course level. So several of you said MIMS, but we need you all on the same page about what does that mean. And so it's about sitting down in your group and defining what it is you mean when you say, here's the certification we say we're doing, down to the course level. That's not to the item level or to the detail yet of, in that class, I want them to learn these things. But to sit down together in your group and say, in this certificate, here's what's part of it. So, of course, next we have up online the Common Course Numbering System, so everybody but Metro uses this. So all of our colleges can crosswalk to, if we start talking about intro to machine shop, for example, we know what all the competencies are in all of these courses. So especially with our articulation agreements, that'll be important. But if you all know a course that you offer and want to say, does this, do you have intro to machine shop? What does that look like? We can pull it up and we can look at the competencies while we're sitting here.
Can anybody hear me?
Hear you.
You can hear me? There's a ton of feedback. George sent me a message that he's trying to speak and can't apparently get it to work.
I think he signed in first or something. Maybe he should connect and call back.
You want us to sign off the meeting and call back in?
Well, I feel fair too, but I'm going to think that George is...
Yeah, George is listed as the host for me.
I wonder if that can't be heard because it is
true. Maybe we should sign off and then log back in.
Okay. Can you hear me, man?
I can hear you. I'm not sure anyone else can hear us. Well, I think they're trying to figure a way to split us away from the regular meeting so we can have our small group discussion.
Carol, I can hear you too, and I can hear Matt, but the other stuff just sounds like it's under an aquarium or something.
Right.
This is Linda Rains at Pikes Peak.
Can you hear us now?
Yes.
Yes. Awesome. How about Curtis? Okay. Welding group is discussing something. Are you able to hear the welding group?
Yeah, no, I can't hear it.
In the background, but
I can't hear anything.
Can't hear it.
So the folks that we have on the line are primarily machining group?
I'm sorry, what was that?
The folks that we have online, is it primarily the machining group?
Yeah.
I think we have Pueblo, Pikes Peak, and Front Range.
Yeah, this is Lamar College. We need to, how do we get on with the welding group?
We want to get on with the welding.
Have a certificate. Ability to go to work or continue their education. The goal also was to, if a student wanted to go through this block and then wanted to go to CCD for manufacturing or for CNC machining, then they could come down and they could take this pathway with CCD. So they have some flexibility in how they want to proceed. In any course that's presented here, we have to, as far as Common Course Numbering, we have to teach 80% within the content. Then you have 20% which you can modify or change or add or whatever. You'll find that most of the processes are reflective in general and give a lot of flexibility.
Can you repeat that, please?
So I think for me, I really wanted to put pen to pencil to it, is defining what is it really?
Yeah, I believe so.
Hear me now?
Hey, there's George.
There's George.
Yeah.
Hi, George.
You're seven.
This is great.
Well, let's talk about machining then.
Well, I wanted to just tell them that we're on a fast track and we can't wait and we're not going to wait. And we're going to develop what we're going to develop, and if they want it.
was my attitude.
Well, and I think I think the goal of this exercise is to say, who already has curriculum developed that we can use as a jumping off point? I mean, we have, and I emailed out a list of the courses that Fort Range is going to develop. Mac 101, Mac 100, 101, 102, 110, 20, 201, 205, 240, 245, MTE 130, EGT 205. So those are courses that are already in the Common Core Learning System. They're already in our catalog. We just need to develop the curriculum. A lot of those were taught here at Front Range in the past, before the program shut down in 2006-ish, and so we'll bring them back. What we need to develop is a turnkey curriculum, because we're anticipating a difficulty in finding machining instructors, and the likelihood of them having taught a whole lot is probably pretty minimal. And so we're looking for lesson plans, handouts, outlines of you know what they're going to cover, PowerPoint presentations, those things. And we want to make sure that we have the NIMS requirements embedded within those that curriculum. So if anyone has curriculum that they're willing to share for any of those classes, we'd be really happy to have it and use that as a jumping off point. So that's kind of what I'm thinking currently.
As long as we're having this conversation, it's not going to save us much time or money. I mean, I guess it would be perhaps tight if we could structure our course similar to what we're already out there, but you know, we've had this conversation with Connie already. We've given her I don't think it's going to shorten the process much. So, I mean, politically, you know, I hear what you're saying, but I'd almost suggest to the group that they glom onto what we're doing.
Well, I think that they're going to put some open educational resources out on their website, and they're not going to put several versions of the same course. And I think that we probably want our course to be put up, to be the one put up. So, because otherwise, how do we meet our part of the deal? I think we do need to have a conversation with whatever college already is offering the course.
Well, I mean, the fact that we all want to adopt a NIMS accreditation means that everybody's course has changed somewhat.
Right, and for some schools, I think it'll probably be a tweaking of an existing course, as opposed to a wholesale development of the course, which is what we're looking at possibly doing. So,
I think that we need to define our terms. So, I mean, when they say curriculum, they're probably referring to syllabus. We say curriculum, we're saying the syllabus plus a set of instructional material.
Right.
And so we could adopt, we are. I mean, basically, we're taking the CCCS syllabus, and we're saying we're going to adopt 80% of it because we have to, or more. But we're also going to be developing instructional materials that you're welcome to use if you want. And those instructional materials could wind up going online to satisfy the OER component.
Right.
But at the same time, we're on a much faster track, you know, to doing that than what the system offers you. We have to have a, you know, January 2015 is their cutoff day. We'll hopefully be on our second cohort already.
Yeah, now we're looking at a June of 14 completion date for all curriculum development.
Okay. Oh, that's what I wanted to say. Couldn't say it.
And what other colleges already have these courses in their catalog and are actually offering them?
Everybody except for Pikes Peak. Although, I don't know about Red Rocks because that is predominantly a high school program that they bring some adult learners in. So I don't know how they're doing it, how they're offering college. Well, maybe they're not offering college credit. Maybe they're offering non-credit instruction for the adult learners that are taking the class. I'm not sure of that. But Pueblo and CC Denver are offering courses right now.
So if Pueblo and CC Denver already offer the courses, why not adopt their curriculum? Why do we have to kind of develop it?
Carol, they don't. Yeah, well, the syllabus is, and they may have a different syllabus than what's already on the CCCS website. It can't be different from that by more than 20%. So we are taking that syllabus as a starting point. You know, Connie Krupp and Stephanie.
Mm-hmm.
When we say curriculum, they are going to be, in other words, if you ask instructors at Pueblo to provide you with, you know, their instructional materials, it's not going to be in a form that it could be used by us. And in fact, we did ask that of their head instructor down there, and it, I don't think it's in the form to provide it to other colleges as instructional material. I think the instructor, each instructor kind of does their own thing to some extent.
So the syllabus and the learning outcomes is what we're going to use for those classes that is already up on the CCCS site?
My understanding is that we're going to start with the syllabus. We're going to look at what is required by NIMS.
Mm-hmm.
And we are going to make whatever changes to the syllabus we have to make so that our courses will provide a pathway to a NIMS certificate for the student.
Well, I think since you plan on having it developed by the end of the summer, right? Is that what you said?
June.
Yeah, you have plenty of time to share it with the other colleges before their January deadline.
It sure would be nice to know if we can incorporate the Immerse to Learn as part of that, but we can only do what we can do at this.
If we incorporate the Immerse to Learn, it would be as a supplemental instructional tool, correct?
Yeah. Well,
see, Jessica, again, I just realized that I will never see her bright smile again. I've had dreams about her. I've lost sleep.
What is that?
I've been privy to
her. What are you doing?
Had dreams about what?
Okay. Matt, are you still there? I think Matt dropped off.
Matt dropped off? Dropped off? Matt? Oh, that's too bad.
He's still listed.
Maybe he muted himself temporarily.
Can you tell me who's caller 7? Who's the one who was saying that their NIMS course was going to be active by summer 14? Okay.
Sorry about that.
I'm not 7. I'm not sure who that
is. Who is caller 7?
Who just asked the question?
Brenda just asked the question, but I'm not caller 7.
Well, I'd like to try to make the comment, and I guess we can get it.
You're kind of far away from your microphone because it's hard to understand you, George.
Better?
Yeah.
Yeah. So from what I heard of this conversation, basically Front Range is going to have their NIMS 1 certificate online by summer 14. And the question from, was it Pikes Peak or Pueblo, was that could they get a hold of the syllabus to see what was there?
Brenda?
Yes.
Yeah, Brenda, this is George. I'm sorry I couldn't speak earlier. So it just takes 3 minutes before you went on our process. Our magnet program got me up to date by fall of 2014. Okay?
Fall, okay, 2014.
So we are in the process of hiring a contractor who's going to work on that. Our curriculum is 5% to that information. And you've instructed the contact she needs to come in with the waiver from those contracts. And she has certificate information of what she can certificate so that will qualify for the certificate. She's a very detailed and comprehensive, including instructor activity. Like I said, very comprehensive. That happened June 30th. It will have full instructions and it'll have to agree to syllabi within plus or minus 20%.
We're getting feedback from what George is saying coming out of the microphone at your room. Can somehow we get away from the microphone in the room that is letting the person who's speaking be heard? I think that's going to be someone.
Well, I have, we actually have 7 lines open. Carol's is open. Carol's mic's open. James, Linda's is open. John, Megan's open. Matt James and Ruth Meese is open as well. So that could be feedback as well.
Yeah, I can hear everyone. This is Matt Jameson.
Well, I hear you clearly. I hear Matt clearly. But when George speaks, I don't understand what he's saying because I'm hearing it twice as if it's coming out of a microphone in the meeting.
Yeah, here at the main office, it was pretty choppy. But what I got from George, and George, correct me if I'm wrong, is the fact that you're going to launch the NIMS 1 certificate fall of 14. You've actually contracted out for the content development. There's going to be a full syllabus, and everything's going to conform to the NIMS 1 certificate, and you should have all of that done, including instructor notes by June 30th of 2014.
Yeah, that's essentially correct, except we haven't formally contracted yet and interviewing, and so we know who we're using.
But that's the plan. So my concern is because we have other schools that actually need to work on the NIMS 1 certificate as well, that if they wait until the 6:30 deadline, they're going to be put behind the timetable to be able to actually create their courses, even if they get content from Front Range. Is there a way prior to 6:30? I assume that your contractor, you're going to have actual, draws, okay, we need the first third of the content by February, the second third of the content by April,
and the final third of the content by June. Is there a way that we can actually send that content that's actually being developed to the other colleges?
Yes, of course, and we do have a timetable. The only difficulty is that not all of the colleges are offering the same courses that we are. So to the extent that a college offers a different course we are going to have a look at.
Right. They will have to actually create that course on their own if it's not part of – from what I hear you saying, you already have a list of courses for the NIM certificate.
The list of courses that are in our 35-credit certificate. Not all of them are required for NIMS, but...
Do we actually have the courses required by NIMS identified somewhere? Because from the system office, we have no idea what courses comprise NIMS 1, NIMS 2, or NIMS 3.
Well, first of all, NIMS does not require courses. They're competency-based. Okay, so we have to go into each one of those courses and determine which skills of the Level 1 certificate we'll be covering in each of those courses. So we don't know exactly at this point which course.
So, when do you anticipate you actually going through your courses and saying, okay, this course qualifies for NIMS competency X? When do you think that's going to happen?
I don't have the exact date that I would expect before the end of the year.
I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
I don't have an exact date. I can depend on exactly when we get our started. I would say that you're very early.
And unfortunately, you broke up, so I'm just going to have to... Do you think you would actually have that broken down by January 2014?
I would hope so.
Okay. So if you could get that to me by, like, January 10th, I can actually feed it to the other schools, and then we can make some decisions as to how they're going to meet if they don't actually have those courses you have. Does that make sense? Does anybody disagree?
Brenda, would you send me an email telling me exactly what you would like from us, and then I'll forward that on to our...
Sure, and who would I be sending the email to?
George.Newman@fundraising.org.
Okay, George, because you're down twice, George. You're as a call-in and also as on the computer, so that's why I'm confused. George Newman, okay. Is there any other questions or concerns? Does anybody else that's on the line actually have a different plan for their NIM certificate? Okay. Yeah.
This is George. Can you hear me again?
Yes, I can.
There's a lot more to getting NIMS accredited than just the curriculum. I hope you know that.
George, can you lead me through the process? Do they actually have to
inspect the facility?
Yeah.
Okay.
It requires each of the instructors to become accredited in the skill areas instructing. It requires the facility to be certified or accredited. And
George, you're breaking up again.
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you now. What I got was that for an M certificate, not only do you have to have the courses, but you have to have accredited instructors, you have to have the facility inspected, and you had one more thing.
The advisory committee has got to be on board in a certain way, which I don't think will be a problem for anybody. They give 18 months to complete the process from start to finish. I don't know that it has to take that long. It's not a trivial process.
So what did you estimate as a time frame for the whole process, George?
We're a little bit different in that, you know, we're not going to have any, not going to have our service. We don't have
Unfortunately, I did not hear anything you said, George. You were breaking up really badly.
George, I think the problem is that you're listed as a conference attendant, and so your laptop may be picking up a verbal, and then you're also caller user 7. So if you could go in and mute maybe the George Newman there and just use the phone, use your caller 7, I think you might be in better shape.
So, George, how long did you estimate to get the NIMS on track?
Just for Front Range, or do you want me to answer for the other schools?
Just Front Range.
Okay. The program, you know, our curriculum would be completed, and we would probably already have started instruction. Your program ever offered some courses in a hard stuff.
We're all okay.
Fine, because they have facility, they're already offering any of the courses that have to sweep, so you don't even have
okay. So George, of what you're developing, what do you think your percentage of instructor created material could be?
I'm sorry, my percentage of what?
Percentage of original content that you're going to create.
How are you going to measure that?
Well, obviously it's not purchased, so even if you're importing something from an existing course that is not publisher material or simulations, like that would be considered original material that you're going to publish to OER.
Yeah, I think all of the materials that we're developing will be OER. The question that we've had is that we would also like to purchase an online curriculum simulation package. And
I'm coming.
George and I are going to have a conversation, Casey and us, to figure this out, because as a consortium, we all have to agree on a percentage of what is actually going to be original content versus what's actually going to be delivered by copyrighted material. And that's the next discussion that should start in about 7 more minutes.
Well, why don't I, can you do this, Brenda, suggestion? I'll give you my phone number. Why don't you give me a call and we can talk offline and I can brief you.
Just send me an email with your phone number and I'll call you.
All right, good.
All right. I'm going to bring the group back together. Respect your time. We have about 25 minutes left. Metro's got a good idea. They actually want me to compile all the certificates and all the courses with the course descriptions so that they can actually review it to see what courses they're actually going to accept for credit as a articulation assistant. And then they're going to actually build in smaller courses or whatever to actually build if we're missing a competency or we're missing a component that's in their program. They're willing to actually build many courses to be able to raise those students up so that they can actually go on for their bachelor's or whatever they need to do. So one of the critical things today is send me your list of certificates, what courses are actually going to be in those certificates, right? And then I'll pull all the descriptions so that they can actually go and try to match what they have at Metro with what we're sending them. And then they're going to make a plan on their curriculum as to how they're actually going to fill in the gaps that we have. The next thing on our agenda was modularization of curriculum. That is, for instance, on competency-based courses, if you have students in coming and they are actually a welder, but for some reason they're missing two or three specific areas in their certificate, is there a way to modularize one of our courses so that they can, instead of taking a whole 16-week course, they can jump into a specific module and finish out that module and test out so that they can actually get credit? That's one of those conversations we have about it. It takes a lot of planning to modularize your curriculum because then you have decisions that do they pay the full price for the whole 16-week course? Do they only pay 2/3? Do they pay for the testing? Been in Chinas before, but they don't have any time to do this together. If they come into us and try to do such a prior thing, we would say, we know 80% of the class that is here in Chinas. No, I don't know part one and two. I think they're part two. And so they wouldn't be able to get credit and they take the whole class. Does that make sense? If they could just do the part two. And so it probably makes sense to get that in the first one part in terms of data assessment. I will do that, and right now we kind of start talking about teaching that if we're going to do it a year. Oh, they have an interim machine class, and so instead of it's still really going to go back and say, oh, let's also try to figure out how to change the content.
I think that's really important for the program to all the people that all get to go. They're scared to take all the prereqs for the entry level. They don't want to do it. We're really trying to get a lot more involvement from Colorado investing money. If there was something outlined, it would be a little bit, in my opinion, underwhelming.
Oh, we can add so many courses.
All examples on credit.
Because then you have lots of special copies for all kinds.
be able to make that work. But you're talking onesie, twosie people out here that need this. We're not talking 20 people who are going to walk in the door and be able to do two-thirds of that class. We may be talking 1 in 200.
What if the content is online? I mean, there are other ways to do
but that class won't be online. They have to be touching the machine to do it, either on a simulator or on an actual machine.
I mean, I think there's a population of schools about schools above 8 machine or welding for that trouble. They're basically maybe not teachers at the time, and they don't know where to go with them. And we're in Colorado, and I think it's a segment that's missing sort of popular talent here, where they don't know where, I can't sit here, where the teachers are going to go. Because they have 4 years, you know, while they offer them, and they definitely have a technical knowledge they have to attend to. And I think it's the same with Genus, where we have clients that have Genus that have been practicing setups, you know, through basic tenants. And they start here, but they don't want to go further up. It's something we hear more and more because we don't know what some of them are doing in-house. So we're hiring a lot of people at a higher level.
And the other question
I
wanted is, things
are going to
be
is there something that's complicated to be done by a person, not complicated to be done by a person.
do this critical problem, someone's going to have to analyze the data. And that's going to take more time, in my estimation, than it will to teach the student in a regular class, which means now we have to have additional faculty or other experts that can analyze all of these individual students instead of taking students from one day to one day.
I thought when you talked about this, there are other ways to analyze the student. That's a part of the field of the evaluation. Let's see where I'm coming from. You have to check their manual ability. And if a person comes to us, say, with AWS level, an SMAW, in my mind, that's equivalent to four of our classes. So they can just move right along. They don't get credit for those classes necessarily. They pay for the class. But that's equivalent to those, so they could go on and do a higher level class with us. So there's a standard that's been developed outside. We acknowledge that because our students, when they finish that fourth course, go and take that class. And most of them pass it. So we see that as that's the level those students are that they onboard as well. Then the question is, how do you get to get those credits? So now they have 60 credits that you need. And the only way in our current system is pay for the test out. In that case, if they pay for 16 credits, what you have to pay for and have that certificate on the American Global site, you could give them the equivalent of an entire semester of welding. But they do have to pay it somehow for us to be able to transcript that credit. Now, I don't know if that's something that Cale's working on as part of what they're doing. If it is, that's good, because somehow they'll have to get over that barrier.
Make that a lot easier. We're asking faculty to build whole campus is, you know, then we're asked, we have to ask to build it in March of that same building. So I think that takes us to the question, or have we already answered the SOW, you know, question? Okay, but now, what answer did we get here on using a book as part of our curriculum?
Right.
Yeah. Pick something out of that book. That's not something you develop. Absolutely. So, you know, in the 5 minutes we have left, is that something we don't answer? I'm not running the show. We haven't got that answer. But I'm adamant that we have to change that from a 90-10, because there is no way that, well, in our budget, we did not do it that way. We're more of a 20-80 or 30-70, which we want to buy the 70% of the 80 to develop the 20. Because we've already been talking about.
And the other thing is that I haven't found anybody that has flat back. So those, if we're talking overall, those are the, whatever it is, if we go 20 or 30, those would be 20 or 30. So that would help everybody else.
Yeah, but when you buy that machine or that deal from the manufacturer, he will have, or she will have, I'm sure will have curriculum on that.
They're going to come out and train our faculty. Now, whether they'll provide us copyrighted materials or all the materials, I don't know.
That
becomes part of that problem. The majority of the course, you'll have to develop themselves. Develop it based on what they show us on how the machine works.
But you'll develop it based on their material that they've been given as they were training you for the machine. Copyrighted material. I'm sure that's all of it.
That's the question we don't respond to. And we won't know that really until the machine survives. Which is months down.
I do too. Having gone through this with round one, and maybe Brenda can give a little input, that, you know, you're asking faculty to develop things that they don't even, that they'll have to, you know, go to a contest expert, a more contest expert than what they are, and that would be a manufacturer, especially for teaching equipment. They're going to have to bring that in.
The comment over here was that you actually have to bring in subject matter experts to develop content. That is going to be a cost. So I should and I know in the corporate world those prices were pretty high. They were per hour, and it was not cheap.
Absolutely. So the difference between our budget, when I budgeted more in supplies than I could buy that material. Now, they budgeted more in labor or faculty or contract so they could hire somebody to write it. Okay, so it's, where are we going to juggle the money? So if we change the percentage, they will have to juggle their money from contract maybe back to supply. So that brings the whole question up there. Absolutely. Once we come to a number. But as Casey said, that's easier to juggle the numbers. I think that's a lot easier to juggle than the percentage.
So we have no resolution for that, which is fine. That's not a problem for me.
I would propose a 2080 resolution to that. But
2080 itself, unfortunately, and this is my opinion, is if you are only doing 20% of original content, if you're trying to take that same course that was built at Maine to Pike Peak, they're going to say, yeah, but we don't have the same software. We don't have the same whatever. So you're only actually bringing 20% of the model.
Absolutely. I see where you're going with that. But if I can say, well, the other 80% is out of this book. Now, you modify that 80% with your 20%, you know, how you're going to deliver it. No, I see what you're saying there, but on the other hand, are we going to pay people to already produce something that's already produced in a better format?
People create something and we don't say this was created with this one, this was created with MasterCamp. We just talk about CAM software that's in general, it's a little bit of a big difference. And we pull it up on our system and we are going to take that course and we're going to develop the content, of course, locally, based on what we have. Now, if we haven't been using the same thing and they want to give us more of it, that's fine.
Right. Right. So why don't I go ahead and by December, the first week in December, we're all going to compile our certificates. The courses you actually send to me in your certificates, the descriptions in those certificates, I'll actually compile them in a database. I'll go ahead and send them to Metro, as well as send them all into everybody, all the actual cohort groups, so you see what everybody's doing. Please note on there whether the course is in use now or is to be developed. And that way we can coordinate who's actually creating things. And then we'll revisit the percentage in December after we see what we're looking at.
You will send that out to us that way and we will.
Absolutely, Bruce. Is that exactly what you want? Tell me what you want me to say.
Well, that way each of us taking our notes will not interpret it differently.
Absolutely. Okay.
Especially by the time I take this back and put this in our content excellence.
Okay, no problem. I'll do that. Does anybody else have any other questions or concerns? Yes.
I have the same question for you. I should not bother this. If we develop one or another classes to make up the difference is sometimes that saving, for example, in a state program that the community college will be doing music programming on the new machine and late. However, we teach a little more general code. So then that class comes from the community college for us. We'll be a little short. We develop one criteria so that
education and class. Especially for TV, I don't think it's negative. It just depends on if someone wants to learn that level, mm-hmm. or machine or development,
yeah.
or they might want to do it.
So they probably already have the MC program or the certificate from the same thing you already. But they want to transfer the class to the method. There is a little difference between that. Okay, so here is what we are talking about, the stacking part. Okay, and we need to think about that a little bit shortly. Does that make sense to you guys?
It's more universal.
Okay.
makes an employer look at the community college situation broadly instead of saying this school is good, this school is not helpful to mental.
No.
It makes you look
at it. Yeah, but it's going to be even
more for the mental.
Well, thank you very much for all coming. I'm a little confused with the details on the line. But hopefully next month we'll meet with Central.
Good luck.
Oh. I want to see that story that you got. I love that.
Okay,
then you're going to
have to cut.
I've been wishing that a week.